The days of unskilled labor are over, with industry adopting more and more technology. It is imperative that employees get accustomed to working in a technology-driven environment. Acquiring some form of skill, both high-tech and soft, is becoming more and more necessary for the workforce to survive in today's world. Even in customer-facing industry, such as retail and banking, employees have to be familiar with English, have good communication skills, and the latest word called P2P skills, person-to-person skills, and a basic grooming and etiquette. All products are getting obsolete, and the day they get launched, they get obsolete within about 2 to 3 years. Today, not only the older generation, but also the younger ones is finding it hard to keep pace with technology. Our population is huge at 1.21 billion. It is fast expanding at a rate of 17% and is integrating rapidly into the global economy. Only 2% of the workforce has undergone skills training in the 15 to 59 age group. A critical element in India's 12th five-year plan is the generation of productive and gainful employment on a sufficient scale. The aim is to absorb the growing working population in an unorganized sector, which contributes about 60% to the country's GDP. It employs workers into micro enterprises, unpaid family work, casual labor, and home-based work on a mammoth scale. In addition, it also absorbs migrant laborers, farmers, artisans, and more importantly, out-of-school rural youth. Skill development is a huge task in rural areas, as the numbers are large. Plumbers, masons, electricians, carpenters, handicraft workers, and weavers are still employing outdated methods in their work. If trained properly, they can give better quality of work and earn more. In fact, the company that I was once associated with were the largest sellers of sewing machines in India. We conducted a 6 days training program on tailoring and sewing machine maintenance for more than 2,000 ladies from backward villages. After finishing the training, they started earning between 1,000 to 3,000 monthly after returning to their areas. Economic development cannot take place without preparing the potential beneficiaries to partake of the same. If beneficiaries are not skilled, it is unlikely they would be able to reap any benefit of the economic development agenda. The assumption most of us make about development is that it is sufficient to offer opportunities. But without the right skill, opportunities cannot be truly put to use. For example, if Tata Steel plans to set up a next big steel plant in an underdeveloped region, it should set a training center on the lines of ITI, which can prepare youth and job seekers to be employment ready. This will ensure that the trickle-down effect actually takes place. However, private sector is not present in the rural areas as they are in the urban cities. NSDC, National Skill Development Council, steps in here, and together with private investment and widespread entrepreneurial interest, our economy will start growing rapidly. We have in our panel today eminent and renowned responsible personalities to share with us their views on current topic, which is skill development and sustainable economic growth. Mr. Dilip Chinoy, currently Managing Director and CEO of National Skills Development Corporation. Prior to NSDC, he was Director General of the Advocacy Group for the Automobile Industry in India, the SIAM, which is the Society of Indian Automobile Manufacturers, where he was responsible for setting the technical, economic, and social responsibility agenda for the automobile industry. Mr. Pradeep Kashyap, founder MART, is known as the father of rural marketing in India. He has been marketing advisor to the Ministry of Rural Development and has served our Prime Minister office and Chief Minister committees on rural development. He is a consultant to World Bank and the United Nations. He was chairman Khadi Commission, National Marketing Committee, and member of NABARD and SIDBI National Advisory Committees. He has also worked in the corporate sector for 20 years. Ambassador Deepak Vohra, his face is very, very familiar to all of us, especially people of our generation. He is currently an advisor to the government of South Sudan. During his long service as an Indian diplomat, he has served in several countries, including France, Tunisia, United States, Chad, Cameroon, Papua New Guinea, Spain, Armenia, Sudan, Poland, etc. Prior to his role in diplomacy, he was an officer on special duty as the technology advisor to the Prime Minister of India. So we now request Mr. Dilip Chinoy to kindly share with us your views.
Okay, so thank you, Dr. Sengupta, Dr. Prasha, Ambassador Vohra, and Pradeep. Ladies and gentlemen, it's good to be back here and be amongst you. I've been here many times, but this is the second in the series of these seminars that I'm addressing. I was here last year addressing a completely different topic. What I'm going to speak to you this afternoon is really skills development for employment and sustainable economic growth. I think I have to say next, is that the cue? Or do I have a clicker here? I have a clicker here, okay. So, you know, this is skill development is a key aspect for India for three reasons. First, we have more people than jobs. So we have to actually either increase the number of jobs that are available or skill people for the world. The second is that there's a mismatch between the jobs that we have and the people that are trained for those jobs. And the third aspect is that education institutions and training institutions are not yet aligned to the needs of industry. That is what, in one of his brief remarks, Dr. Sengupta talked about. The other aspect is, if you look in terms of productivity, and this is why is it important to have people skilled. If you take productivity levels in the USA versus India, we are 1/10 of the productivity of, let's say, the US, and even lower than most of the countries like Australia, France, Germany, Japan, South Korea, Russia, Brazil, and China. So on the BRICS, we are the lowest in terms of productivity. If we increase our productivity, we increase our competitiveness, we increase market share, we create more jobs, and then economic growth is actually different. But the interesting challenge is that wherever you are in the world, you're finding employers finding a difficulty to get people to actually employ, to be a skills capital of the world as we go forward. The very interesting part about this whole situation is that 83% of the educators believe that they are training people for the world of work. And 53% of the people in the world of work say that they can't find people to employ. And that's the big challenge. If I were to look at the management space itself, I don't want to disappoint the young students and the faculty here, but over the last year, management admissions across the country have declined by 20%. Only 8% of the management students that graduate find a job in the specialization of their choice. Perhaps it does not apply to ILM, but that is a general statistics. And what is interesting is that the students and the children within education institutions are realizing that there's this wide chasm between the world of education and the world of work. So they are leaving the world of education and entering the world of work. And therefore, you reach that statistic that Dr. Sengupta talked about, that only 2% of the people are skilled. So if you want to change this, there are four challenges. The first challenge is that there's just not enough capacity to train people in India. And just like there was not enough capacity at one time in the management space, you had only the IIMs, and then the private sector came up, and you had institutions such as where we stand today come into the space. We need the private sector to enter the skill space. The second is that there's a huge mismatch between what is being desired by industry and the quality standards don't actually match up. The third is that while you have access to educational loans, should you so desire, most people don't have access to 5 to 10,000, 15,000 rupee loans to actually pay to get skilled and take it forward. And then, while many of us aspire to join a management college, nobody really aspires to become a plumber or a welder. So you would have, you know, management graduate seeks groom or bride, but you'll never see in the matrimonial columns a welder or a driver seeking a bride or a bridegroom. So that is the aspiration challenge as we have it. So to bridge this, the NSDC was created. We have three main tasks: create the vision for large-scale skill development, second, to fund, and third, to enable. So the first thing that we did was we tried to find out what industry wants. So we surveyed different industries, and we found that there's a requirement of millions of jobs and different growth opportunities in different sectors. Then we said, how does this pan out across the states and at every district? So we mapped every district in terms of a skill gap analysis. And what we did, another study that we did, where Pradeep actually led that work through MART, was analyze the number of trainers that are required in the country. What we found was very interesting, that in the areas where there was large job requirements in different states, people were not willing to get into that industry. So should you graduate out of this institution and work in that job and be in the HR function, the reason why you're not getting people is because people are not attracted to your industry. Not that your company is not good. So you've got to actually make your industry more attractive going forward. So that is an aspiration challenge that we need to solve. Second is to enable industry to align their standards and their needs and communicate to the training institutions that you've got to train to those skills. We set up sector skill councils that are industry-led and industry-managed. And what they have done is they have taken out close to 990 standards, you know, across different areas at different levels. So if you train to the standard, then industry is going to certify you and hire you. And what we have done to make it more aspirational is that traditionally, this was the education system. And this was the vocational system, or the way in the companies. And there was no bridge. So we started to create a national skills qualification framework, which equates a class with this, like a class 12, the skilled person, or actually enables you to identify a graduate who cannot be employed as an unskilled person, or enable a graduate who's got some skill to be a supervisor or a skilled worker. So this qualification framework is in place, and we are going to see progression across vertical, horizontal, and other aspects here. The other thing that we have done is that when you join a company and you look at a sector, you don't have a career map. So we have developed these career paths that you can actually look at and see if you start as an assembly knitting or operator in the textile industry, how you can become a quality manager or production manager going forward by accumulating credits and as you go forward. Now, what is interesting is this has been adopted in 10 school boards as we speak. West Bengal was added yesterday, so this slide keeps getting kind of outdated every time I make a presentation. It has been adopted by the UGC and AICTE, so it can actually apply to you if you're affiliated to AICTE. And a lot of the skills missions are looking at it. Interestingly, we signed up with Australia to provide a bilateral agreement to recognize skills certified in India with those of Australia. So what we're trying to do here is that a system that was divorced from industry and the world of work was divorced from the world of education, we've got the sector skill councils to actually set up the standards to get defined job roles, to align courses, certify people, and then employ them. So if you are an engineer and you wanted to get into the industry, into the IT sector, NASSCOM would come and certify you. And then they can't make a statement that, you know, we can only hire 25% of the people who passed out because they've actually certified all of you. So very interesting. What has been the impact so far? The impact so far is We have about 171 private sector training partners in the whole ecosystem. We have 31 sector skill councils. We have about 14 different entities that are hiring from job portals that are hiring from this, 11,400 employers, and we have 10,000 plus other, the corner that you see employers enrolled in the system. Last year, year before last, we did 400,000 people. Last year we did 10 lakhs, or 1 million. This year our target is 33 lakhs, and next year we hope to get 66 lakh people through the system. So where does it all add up? If you look at this, and this is a very interesting graph between human development and economic growth, and it is found wherever, especially in countries like China, USA, and India, wherever the human development index, economic growth has actually moved in kind of 99.99% correlation. So it's very clear that if we have a skilled workforce in India, we would improve productivity, we would improve competitiveness, and we could really become the skills capital of the world. So there are only very few things which are required. Educational institutions such as yours need to reach out to the sector skill councils. There is a sector skill council for management in the work, which is only 2 minutes walking distance from you. It's a house in IMA. You can align yourself, look at the different sectors, and take it forward. So what we're trying to do here, very, very briefly, is transforming the lives of millions of young people in the country so that India could become the skills capital of the world and an economic superpower as you go forward. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and later on I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Mr. Chinoy, sir, it's always a pleasure to hear you speak. The contribution of the National Skills Development Corporation is commendable, and thank you so much for sharing your insights. It is truly an integral part of the company's development and progression path, and we are glad that we have you here to share all this with us. Mr. Kashyap, sir, may I please request you to...
My distinguished colleagues on the dais, faculty and friends. For the last 30 years, I have stood at such forums as an expert, but today I decided that I'm going to stand here as a common citizen and not bring any expertise, but ask some very basic questions. You know, the objective of such a session is for us to learn and enhance our knowledge on a particular subject. And today we are talking about skills. So I thought I will raise 10 fundamental questions, and my distinguished colleagues on the dais or others could possibly try and address some of these questions, which will then help us to learn a little more about the sector. In 2009, the then Prime Minister announced that we are going to skill 500 million people in this country by 2022. At that time, the total workforce of India was 460 million. And that represented about 40% of the population, because it was 460 million of 1.2 billion people. So if you project that to 2022, this figure goes up to a little beyond 500 million. Okay. So the first question that comes to my mind is, how will you skill every possible worker in this country? Okay. And more fundamentally, from where does this figure of 500 million people come? And I've asked a lot of people who are experts in this field, that was there a study undertaken to arrive at this figure of 500 million? Okay. I have not got an answer that any study was undertaken. I was told that C.K. Prahlad, when he addressed the CII at 75, he had done a back of the envelope calculation, and he put across a figure of 500 million, and that figure has stuck with the Prime Minister and with the rest of this country. So my fundamental question is that how can a country decide to embark on such an ambitious program, which has never been attempted by any nation any time in the history of this planet, without having even a basic study done on what is the total number of people that needs to be skinned? Now, this total figure of 500 million people includes 100 million daily wage labor. So the question I want to ask is, what kind of skills are we going to impart to this daily wage labor? How to dig the earth? How to lift that basket of loose earth? And are we going to have national occupation standards for these 100 million people? Let's take another example. There are 20 million beedi rollers, you know, people who make beedis. So are we going to skill these 20 million beedi workers to produce tighter beedis and put the thread around properly and pack and wrap the beedis better? We have 8 million kirana stores in rural India. And I'm talking more about rural India because that's where my focus has been for the last 30 years. Now, what kind of a training are we going to give to these 8 million kirana stores and 2 million pan shops? So, and are we going to have a 3-week course for them? And again, it doesn't quite fit in my view of things. So, My belief is, and I could be entirely wrong, and I think Dilip would be there to correct me more than anybody else, my belief is that the entire skill sector has been approached in a rather unscientific, casual manner. Let's now come to NSDC, and Dilip has already talked about his organization. NSDC has been given the task of skilling 150 million people. Between 2010, when it was established, and by 2022. And as Dilip himself shared, that in the first three and a half years, NSDC has trained about 3.5 million people. Yeah. So at an average of 1 million people per year, whereas their target is about 10 million people per year. So is it realistically possible? Fifty percent of our total workforce out of this 500 million people are engaged in agriculture. Okay. And in fact, 70% of our total population and our working population depends on agriculture. Almost all projects that have been sanctioned by NSDC so far have been in the non-agricultural sector. Okay. So if we have to achieve this target of 150 million people to be skilled, there is no way on this earth that you can scale 150 million people without including people from the agricultural sector. So unless we have a much stronger focus on the agri and allied sectors, I think we will miss the bus by a long distance. Question number five. 93% of our employment is in the unorganized sector. Only 7% of our workforce is in the organized sector, and out of that, not even 5% is in the manufacturing sector. And out of that, the organized, that is the large industry, is even less than that, because then you also have the small scale sector. Right? So the question here is that, yes, we can perhaps cater to and locate these 35 million people who are working in the organized sector, but how will we locate the remaining 465 million people, and how will we train these 465 million people, many of whom are doing daily wage and beedi rolling and pan selling and what have you? Okay. Question number six. Corporate India has not added a single job in the last 5 years. It's been a complete jobless growth. Okay? So even if we train this workforce in these different sectors, where are they going to be absorbed? Where are they going to find employment? Question number 7. Between 2010 and 2022, over 100 million youth will enter the job market, and that includes people like you. Okay? They will come from 183 senior secondary schools which have a current enrollment of 46 million. This is the essential catchment area for taking up people for skills development. The world over, vocational education training is mandatory. Okay? It is by a law that every school in countries like Germany, Switzerland, Sweden, even places like China, Thailand, Indonesia, and other countries, it is mandated that every school must have vocational education training, because that is the catchment area. In India, we have no such law. And not even 3% of our workforce finally comes through this route, whereas it should be at least 75 to 80% coming through this route. So unless we bring about systemic corrections, we are not going to be really addressing the real issues. It's very obvious to say that we have a demographic dividend. We have the youngest people in the world. More than 50% of our population is under the age of 25. Sure, it's a demographic dividend, but unless we bring about a change in the overall ecosystem of the skills sector, this demographic dividend can become a demographic disaster. Okay. Question number 8, how will we tackle the cultural factors? The mindset in this country is that mind work is superior, and therefore the IAS, the IITs, the IIMs are the ones who are the preferred lot. And whereas jobs like that of a carpenter or a mason or a mechanic are considered below, you know, most people's dignity, and therefore how will we enroll these people to take up these professions? To give you an example, the dignity of labor, which we are all aware in this country, you know, I used to work with Toyota many years back, 3 decades back actually, and when I used to visit Japan, the janitor in Japan is designated as the sanitation engineer. That's the way dignity is built. And that's something that we haven't done in this country. So question number 9. To train this large workforce, we require a minimum of 500,000 certified trainers. Okay? It'll take years to create this large pool of qualified trainers. And this is the study that Dilip was referring, which our organization has done for NSDC, is on the requirement of trainers. So if you have to train 150 million people and you work out a certain trainer-trainee ratio, then you need 500,000 trainers. And today we hardly have any. So we have to create these trainers. For that, you have to have a career path for trainers. Do you know, today in India, if you become a trainer in an ITI or any one of these private institutions, you join as a trainer, you retire as a trainer, you die as a trainer. There is no career path. We are sitting in an academic institution. There is a career path for professors. You join as a lecturer, you become a reader, you become an assistant professor, you become a professor, you become a professor emeritus, and what have you. So there is a career path. So why should people enroll to become a trainer? In fact, so far, the situation has been that if you don't get any other job, end up as a trainer. So, you know, as they say, that sort of rubbish in, rubbish out, and that's what's going to happen. If you don't have quality trainers, the quality of our training is going to be poor, the trainees are going to be of poor quality, and then the IT sector and others will come back and say that these people are not employed because they have not been trained properly. I want to end this question session on a positive note and a happy note, which is that by 2020, India will have a workforce surplus of about 56 million. And the rest of the world will have a shortage of about 47 million. So it is a tremendous opportunity where the entire shortage in the world can be met by the excess in this country. But for that, we have to build the right ecosystem, we have to be realistic about our targets, and we have to do things the right way. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kashyap. The skill gap is truly daunting, and the points that you brought up are highly pertinent. The first one that I noted down, one of them was the workforce that needs to be roped in from the unorganized sectors in rural India. There is also the challenge of growth in corporate India for the last 5 years, and there are there is a paucity of jobs where skilled workforce can be employed. The fact that we don't have a vocational training framework which mandates vocational training again is a challenge. And dignity of labor, of course, is something that we as Indians haven't done very well for many, many
5,000 years.
Yes. While I was listening to you, I was also reminded of what you had mentioned about No Career Path. And I think there as well, what Mr. Chinoy shared about the career path that they've developed as part of the NSDC is something that is.
I think a question answer or response to that question.
I'm sure.
In 3.5 minutes, not 10 minutes.
And another area where I think NSDC has done work, which is commendable, is the integration. They're trying to integrate the vocational training to the university systems. Thanks so much. We're optimistic, sir, and by 2020, like you shared, we're very optimistic that we will be able to achieve what we've set out to. Thank you so much. May I now invite Ambassador Deepak Vora to share his insights, please.
We have the I use this one. I have my own, just tell me which one. Professor Sengupta, Mr. Chinoy, Mr. Kashyap, and Mrs. Barasha, faculty of the IILM, distinguished guests, students, ladies and gentlemen, when such a good-looking ambassador stands in front of you, look at him. I've just returned from Guinea after spending 9 days in hospital for suspected Ebola. If that has accelerated the onset of Alzheimer's, please forgive me. To our friends from Australia, thank you for clobbering us in cricket. I trust IILM hasn't denied you breakfast, lunch, and dinner. As Foreign Service officers, we are trained not to comment on the internal affairs of any country, particularly our own. So I shall be speaking not about employment in India, or sustainable development, whatever that animal means. But we shall be talking about Africa, where I have spent half my career. I am literally married to a daughter of Africa. We haven't divorced yet. We've been married for many years. So may I then talk a little bit about how we see this issue and this challenge in Africa. Forward to the past then. This one. Thank you very much. Thanks for saving my battery. Right. We move on with this. Where do I point this? Doesn't work. It's made in China, it won't work. Let me try mine. All right, let's try mine. That's made in Japan, that too won't work. Oh, that does, all right. Now, this is an article that came out in The Atlantic 2 years ago, and it talked about the white savior, basically, going to save the black fellow. When we had this Ebola crisis, the myths were spread that the Africans were no good, that we couldn't do anything on our own, and it would be the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, et cetera, that would deal with it. And very few know that this stupid senior Indian official who traveled with the Prime Minister of Guinea to a remote village where the white saviors, forgive me, our white friends, refused to go, He spent not 5 but 9 days in quarantine, and he now stands before you. This is something that we saw in Africa. The newest do-gooders who will change the world are these social entrepreneurs. This is the biggest thing now in the United States and in many universities around the world. These are people who are going to come because they will empower the poorest of the poor, and they are going to transform our planet. I'm afraid it's not going to work, because this is taking into account, forgive me, this takes into account the existing structures that they work within. The main limitation is not the bright young people that we see. The main limitation is this model ignores what is hidden. And that we shall talk about for Africa in a moment. What does sustainable development mean? We'll take a very quick look. Is it China since 1990? Very rapid growth, or India, very slow growth? Is European American development no longer sustainable? Probably not. What is the correlation between employment and development, and how do we move on with development? Yes, ma'am. Sometimes, this is Africa, it looks very nice, sometimes called the mother continent. Minimum wage in Australia in 2015, dollars, $18 per hour. Well done. Can you give me a migrant visa? All right. Minimum wage in Uganda in 2015, dollars, $2 per month. Two per month. Sustainable development? Thank you very much. Fashionable to talk about drivers of development. How about talking about the drivers of poverty? Certain things drive development. What drives poverty? Are there mindsets? Are there education? Is it experience? Is it the ecosystem? It's a very fashionable term to use. No amount of technology, dear friends, is going to change the drivers of poverty. Idi Amin of Uganda, if you recall, I was just about born then in 1972. He kicked out the Indian community, the Asian community. Robert Mugabe kicked out all the whites. South Africa's transition to black rule, we saw a great deal of economic contraction, and the lack of local skills and expertise was cited as the reason in all three. International development aid, from the African perspective, is dying. We don't buy it anymore. Look, we've been in the aid business for 60 years. The figure that I'm talking about, the figure that is talked about, is $500 billion. Why are then the poor people getting poorer? Why is the gap widening? Do you really believe that Mr. Bono or Mr. Bill Gates or Mr. Bill Clinton will save the world by singing and dancing on Africa aid concerts? Some people will never learn. I've never seen a report prepared by these rackets called the World Bank and the IMF, which doesn't have a price tag. The latest one is that to ensure that all young people attend lower secondary education, they want $8 billion. Now, who invents these figures, where they come from? You've all heard this expression that even the devil can quote scripture for his purpose. Every expert can invent statistics for his own purpose. 1960, the pro-poor leaders of the world were thrown out in coups. When coups went out of fashion, the World Bank and the IMF came, talked about structural adjustment, not a word about skills development. Please read those reports. Structural adjustment in your economies. Nothing about skills development. Right now, you can see the figures. The structural maladjustment was the greatest single cause of poverty. Official sources like the UN claim that poverty has been halved in the last 15 years. Oh, really? Come to Lesotho, come to Guinea, come to South Sudan, and I'll tell you what the reality is. It has doubled, not half. This is a trick of, you make the poverty level to 1 cent per year, the whole world is above the poverty line. Rather shady British fellow, forgive me if there are English people here, named Tony Blair, he talked about debt relief to Africa, said we want true democracy, we want this, that, and the other. And then he said, Mr. Mugabe's henchmen in Zimbabwe are terrible fellows. They are clobbering the whites. This is one of my favorite books about Africa. It tells you how to write a book about Africa. Pretend to be concerned. Show a picture of a woman with a huge chest, forgive me, or a fellow wearing traditional dress, or a child with an extended belly. End with a quotation from Nelson Mandela, because you care. You're going to change Africa. Transparency, corporate social responsibility, wonderful, wonderful buzzwords. Mr. Bill Gates has just funded the Narrative Project. which is talking about things like partnership, equality, shared values, etc. Like McDonald's ad says, I am loving it. Most of the 25 bottom nations in the UN Development Index are African. One in five Africans has access to electricity. One in seven lives in a brick and mortar home. One in seven has access to clean drinking water. Sustainable development? Thank you, my friends. This presentation, I have been in Africa 40 years talking to leaders and business people. Look at this. In all 54 countries in Africa, the biggest hurdle is the lack of job creation. Developing job-related competencies, we talked about it. In sub-Saharan Africa, over 100 million people between 15 and 25, one out of three of the region's youth population do not have basic skills for employment. 72% of youth in Africa, less than $2 per day. Uganda, Nigeria, Ethiopia, Zambia, Lesotho, all the countries where I advise the governments, the highest rate of poverty. Poverty, hunger, inclusive growth, these are the biggest challenges that Africa faces. No one is going to come and develop us. Development has to be autochthonous. It has to be autonomous. Ultimately, each country's prosperity depends on how productive its people are. I just heard that the Americans are 10 times or 20 times more productive than we are. We are 20 times more reproductive than they are. We produce many more children. We talk of the informal sector. Everybody in India wants to move people away from the informal sector to the formal sector. Please, I plead with all the policymakers, including my Prime Minister, don't ever make that mistake. Because then you'll have an army of unemployed, and an army of unemployed is more dangerous than any regular army anywhere in the world. What is needed is employment, not just GDP figures. Look, this is just to give you an idea. North Africa employment, youth employment is 30% today. Every unemployed adult, four jobless young people. In South Africa, amongst the youth, it's 80%. Is that sustainable? You know, this is a guest lecturer at Lund University in Sweden, and he was talking about Yemen. And the one thing he said, which struck me a great deal, he says the solution lies in opening the Gulf market to workers from Yemen. He says, we have this army of unemployed. Where do we go? Tunisia. Do you know what actually happened, how the Arab Spring started? Because this man, who was a university postgraduate, an MBA, if I have not forgotten, used to sell fruit to support his family. And a police officer came and said, you don't have a license. So he doused himself with kerosene and set himself on fire. And then the Arab Spring began. It was unemployment, not sustainable development, that started the movement. So Iraq, the Iraqi army, 2003, was disbanded by some fellow called Bremer by the stroke of a pen. 250,000 people. 80% of the suicide bombers were these 250,000 suddenly unemployed members of the army. Unemployment, trust me, is something that destroys not just your body, it tears into your soul. World Bank, skilled and knowledgeable workforce improves investment climate because skilled workers create an attractive environment. Oh, really? They do? Thank you very much. What happens when the minerals run out in these countries that have so much of it? What happens when the African countries, which have weak regulatory structures for protection of their workers? In the USA, I read that some fellow was killed in an industrial accident. He earned, his family got $1 million. The highest paid in Africa to date by a Western company is $10,000, because my life is less precious than yours. So may I just say that the African clock is ticking. The workforce is going to surpass both China and India. We have to look at the possibility of giving our people sustained employment. May I request you, therefore, Africa represents less than 1% of world manufacturing capacity. African agriculture has been destroyed. What the Chinese development model, the Indian development model, forget about this. What Africa has to have is those amazing skills for survival. Those need to be encouraged. Looking into the past patterns of African growth and trade, we have to look at that, invest in skills development, and we have to ignore the experts, except those people sitting here. They are wonderful people. May I rephrase the debate? Sustainable employment for sustained development. You can't quote this because I've just filed for a copyright, but it's sustainable employment for sustained development. Development can never, never be sustainable. It's employment that has to be sustainable. And this can only come from agriculture, industry, and those services that support manufacturing and that support agriculture, which is basically banking, which is whatever else you have, logistics, marketing, telecom. That is what we are attempting to do in South Sudan. That's what we are attempting to do in Lesotho, in Guinea, in Nigeria, in Rwanda, in Burundi. All governments I interact with, and we have succeeded to some extent. Do not laugh at the informal sector. The global economic crisis is hurting everybody. Interestingly, an imaginative statistic, more people are moving from Portugal to its former colony, Mozambique, because of job opportunities, than are moving from Mozambique to Portugal. We find a lot of white people there. Let us not mistake aspiration for achievement. Please, Africa is not going to follow any models, because the monkey that tried to fly like the eagle plunged to its death. That's an African proverb. Thank you very much indeed.
I was walking away with
Thank you, Ambassador Vora. Sir, thank you so much for sharing all of what you've shared, your insights on the situation in the African subcontinent and Asia. The true scenario is discouraging. It is disheartening. But like I said earlier, we're optimistic and. Sustainable employment for sustained development, it is. So while I was listening to our panelists, I was reminded of something that Mark Twain had once said, and I'm a student of literature. He said, two of the most important days in a man's life are the day that he was born and the day that he discovers why. The need is to empower a workforce with skill development to aid appropriate and productive employment. In essence, meaningful and satisfying work for all. We are very grateful again for the insights of all our esteemed panelists. We now throw the house open for questions. I know that there would be questions from the panel here.
Been already.
Hi. I have a question to the panel. All said and done, I mean, everybody has spoken. You know, private organizations have set up training centers to enhance livelihood opportunities. Hindustan Unilever is a case in point, where they set up training centers for retail chains near their factory, which is in the suburbs. And the government of India also has undertaken huge projects to provide low or free, I mean, cost of vocational training. Which has happened in Chhattisgarh. However, as per information, the turnout and participation from the target population is low, since the daily earnings are getting impacted because of NREGA, or people want to remain in their comfort zone. You know, if they enroll for these programs, so how can this be addressed?
Thank you. Looks like I'm going to be at the question answering mode here. Absolutely. But I think three things, you know, the problem, and I try to, I think I was quite fascinated by Ambassador Vora's presentation, because India is really a microcosm of Africa in many ways that you see that. And that's a real challenge that we're wanting to address. You know, I liked your monkey analogy or the aspiration. And the problem is that industry pays peanuts. So they'll get monkeys. And monkeys who want to soar like eagles fall flat. So the challenge is that people are not attracted to skill development programs because they find a career after a skill development program not up to the aspiration. So the aspiration and the focus group discussions that we did at district level, the highest growth sectors, logistics, which is a service industry, construction, leather, chemicals, textiles, nobody wants to join those industries. Because kids today say, if I want to spend 8 hours And why service is attractive or retail is attractive, you spend 8 hours in an air-conditioned environment, okay, you have to stand. So banking is preferred to retail because at least in a bank job you sit, right? So, that's the big challenge. And our proposition is that please don't offer anything free because free has no value.
No value.
But then you have the challenge which Ambassador Vora talked about. If a person earns less than 1 cent a day,
how can he
pay for it? And so we are proposing this whole vocational loan program, but employers have to pay more. And employers will only pay more if they find a value in taking a person who is skilled versus a person who is not skilled. So the only difference is productivity. The only difference is attitude. The only difference is knowledge. So if you do that, then we have to change the whole environment and moving away from the word ecosystem. But you need to have a pull. So management was attractive some years ago because companies were offering virtually specialized jobs to management students. Today, started by Maruti, car companies want management students to sell cars and you pay them 6,000 or 7,000 rupees a month. That does not even service the loan that they've taken for management. So, you have this whole challenge. So I think we have this dichotomy and we have to address this. And we are saying that, you focus the government programs at the bottom right-hand corner of the aspiration chart, but leave the rest for creating shared value. Again, it's a term I'm using from your presentation, but using a different context.
I'm not sure. Oh, yes, you can hear me now. In Africa, what we are trying to do in terms of sustainable employment in several countries, you talked of the construction industry. I should have perhaps explained that the Arab Spring in Egypt, the origins, 80s and 90s, we were told that all of the Maghreb, Northern Africa, was growing exponentially.
Oh.
Lots of foreign investment. We'll build roads, we'll build buildings. Great, everybody was very excited. When that construction finished, the buildings were done, the roads were done, then what happens to those fellows who were working there? They went out. That wasn't sustainable employment. What we are now looking at in the countries where I'm privileged to serve is agriculture. You may not need electricity, you may not need oil, you may not need an elegant suit, but you'll always need food. So what we are trying to do is upgrade the skills of the people in agriculture, whether it's small farms or large farms, rather than take them out of agriculture into other areas. In fact, construction, in our experience, has been the most disastrous sector in terms of sustained employment. Because once you've finished it, like in Europe today, I'm not even sure how many people work in construction. 1% perhaps of the workforce? Because everything that could be built has been built. Then what? But agriculture, the need is perennial. Manufacturing, at the lower end, the need is perennial. And the service industries that service agriculture and industry. That is what we are attempting to focus so that the employment is sustainable. And a person's self-respect, his sense of honor, is maintained. There's another African proverb. If your wife has to go to beg for food to the neighbors, then you're only half a man. There's a lot of traditional wisdom in Africa. And that's what we are trying in Africa, to look at African solutions to African problems. I'm not going to be around very much longer. I'll soon be a photograph on a wall somewhere with a garland around it. But this new trend that we have started, many of our leaders are beginning to look at alternatives to the model-based approach to development. We are looking within to see how we can look into the past and draw out patterns of sustained employment, sustainable employment, and the growth will then follow. It is not that development leads to employment, it's that employment leads to growth. The word is paradigm shift. I don't know what that means, but that's the terminology that is being used. I'm sorry, did it make any sense?
It did?
Oh, thank you very much. Double my fee, guys, if you're listening.
So,
Pradeep, you want to add something to that?
Yeah, maybe we will.
I just want to take his 10 questions and in very, very briefly. You know, the first challenge we have as a country is that we're going to have, between now and 2022, we are going to have 276 million people who will turn 18. Okay, that's the census 2011 figure.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, so let's not, 276 million people are going to turn 18. So we either got to have them in education, training, or workforce. So I think 500 minus 276 million is the question mark. Now, all I'm saying is, let us assume we are an institution with 476 workers today. Forget millions, forget everything. In the next 8 years, I am sure at least one of them will have to go for one skill upgradation program in the next 8 years, at least one. If in the teaching fraternity, you will have to go through three refresher courses to go into your next level, right? So the average is three. Now just add 1 million. So 476 million in the workforce, assuming you have to train them once in the next 8 years, forget the three times, and you're saying all the 276 who actually join the workforce, you get a number of 476 plus 276, which is close to 750 million. So the number is actually larger. Yeah. And I think Ambassador Vora said it very nicely, because we anticipate there will only be about 250 million jobs. So the challenge is, what do you do? As a country, if I'm a family, if only one person can get a job in India, should I have the opportunity to train my other two children who can go and work abroad, or should that opportunity not be there? So I think that, you know, we need, there's a lot of debate, and a lot of economists and professors have done regression analysis that said, just look at the census numbers and you'll get the answer, you know, because the census does not lie. So that's a big issue.
Yeah, I'm going to answer that.
You know, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So you can say, I'll only, you know, do half of them, whatever it is. But the fact is, 276 million people who turn 18, you need to do that. And you have to do it in school. You have to do it in college. So you have to integrate it in school. But the big challenge in school is, as a parent, you're saying best of four into university is only English, physics, chemistry, and maths. Where does skill fit in? He doesn't need to do skill. So the universities, you accept a skill as part of it, and management schools, starting with ILM, should accept a skill as a best of four, or you know, but you do a different admission process. The other challenge here is that 93% or the 20 million BD workers or 8 million Kirana stores, and Basics, which is a very interesting thing, has started a Kirana store training program. Coke wants to do 5 million Kirana stores earlier, because the biggest loss to Kirana stores is they don't know how to stack their stuff. They lose a lot of stuff to rodents. They lose a lot of stuff because they don't know first in, first out. They don't know expiry dates. So they have a big challenge. So we need to train them. Pawn shops now, the 2 million pawn shop guys have to get skilled and get a certificate in the next 6 months. Otherwise, they're going to lose the license to hold a pawn shop. Reality. That's the food bill which has come in, and all the hawkers which is actually coming in. So, you know, we're actually creating a whole set of regulations which are actually going to ensure that the people need to be skilled. The agriculture piece is really, really interesting, because today a lot of people are underemployed in the agricultural space, and the productivity in the agriculture space is, you know, take rice, paddy, wheat, paddy and rice, wheat, or take any cereal that's got a minimum support price, our productivity is lower than even Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Bhutan. But if you take anything where there's industry pull, whether it's oil seeds or sugarcane, our productivity is highest. And we have started training in banana, in rice cultivation, in coffee plantation, in tea plantation, and the productivity has been increasing, and the outcome for the farmers has actually been going up, and more people have been encouraged to actually enroll in this. We had a campaign which we launched on television. In the last 1 month that we ran the campaign, we got close to 10 lakh calls. 17% of them wanted to be trained in agriculture, because they learned that beekeeping, and they found that this was a livelihood, actually, opportunity. So you got to create livelihoods. How do you, you know, we are a land-starved country. And if we grow at the same rate that we are growing, there's going to be a shortage of food. So there are places where, can you cultivate three crops at the same time on the same piece of land? Potato, green leaves, and other subtubular things. So these are the types of things that we actually need to bring in here. The school program, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th, we have integrated it. It's 24 states. 10,000 schools will happen this year. We're asking the Prime Minister to scale it up and do all these schools as we go forward. The dignity of labor is a big issue. And before we end the session, I'll ask for 90 seconds because I want to just show you something that we are doing here. And I think that is really looking at this unorganized sector and how do you actually enable that to happen. That is a big challenge. We've not been able to crack that yet. There is this career path thing that we actually talked about. How could a domestic cook, right, become a chef in a hotel? So any guesses, what is the annual salary of the executive chef in the, let's say, Taj hotels? Any guess?
More than mine.
It's like a pilot.
Five lakhs. Okay.
Well, 5 lakhs a month.
Oh, 5 lakhs is nothing.
5 lakhs per month.
It's like a pilot.
1.5 what?
Crore.
That's right.
Yeah.
1.5 crores
is
actually what the executive chef gets. And how many of you have seen MasterChef? MasterChef?
Australia.
Yeah, MasterChef Australia, right? You know why they started MasterChef Australia? Because Australia wants to be a tourist destination. Tourists eat food. Australian cooks were non-existent. So how do you create an aspiration for people to take up careers in the food and in industry? So that's what actually led to the creation of MasterChef. In trainers, thanks to the study done by MART, there's an Education Sector Skill Council being created. We will have a career path for trainers. Trainers can then land up to be the heads of the institutions, like professors or teachers can head up being principals. But that's the Education Sector Skill Council that we are trying to address. We have to formalize the informal sector, because today the informal sector there's an informal sector and there's an informal black sector. So, you know, we have to address the latter by formalizing this. And therefore, you are seeing the changes in the pension and the EPF Provident Fund laws to allow this to happen. So a lot is happening. And the whole objective is to end on the positive note that Pradeep talked about, is that we are very clear. What is very clear, even if we grow at the best that we want to grow for in the next 10 years, there are going to be 56 million surplus Indians for the rest of the world. So the idea is that all the people who exist in India and they're going to be going to add to the working age going forward, can we empower them by them having a certificate that is recognized anywhere in the world, whether it's Africa or Australia or the US or Europe, that they can get a job? So that's the collective effort that we're trying to do. And that's the transformation in lives that we're trying. And your role in that is absolutely critical.
We still have some time, so if we have any questions from the audience.
Good afternoon to all.
Good afternoon.
So for being competitive, every country needs to align its skills training policies with industrial and economic policies.
Do they?
Industrial and economic policies. So what is your opinion about the success of implementation of such policies, especially across the Asian and African subcontinent?
Africa, I'll leave to them. Asia, I'll give an example.
Shall we ask them to respond?
Right, sir.
Good. Thank you very much. Being a television person, I ask questions. We normally don't give answers, but
okay.
Go ahead.
You know, if you look at India, we recently had the session on Make in India, right? So Make in India has identified 25 sectors, right? Now, Make in India sectors were identified independent of NSDC. But I talked to the sector skill councils. We actually have 25 sector skill councils exactly mirroring those sectors. And the 20 high growth sectors that were selected for NSDC mirrored the planned development of India. But what happened is there's a lot of unplanned development that is happening. The beauty industry is exploding. The security guard industry is exploding. The retail industry is exploding. There were some jobs that are not prevalent 2 years ago. I don't know if you've actually adopted a course of digital marketing in IILM. If you've not, and if you passed out of the marketing specialization, 99% you won't get a job, because most of the marketing is moving to digital marketing. So the alignment is there. What we need is execution, right? So the standards have been created. Let's say the management standards have been created, but if IILM were not to take the curriculum to its board of studies, to its academic council, to its whatever it is, and then accept it, it's not going to work. So that's the alignment that we're looking for.
Okay. Well, I want to share two, three very fundamental things. The first is this whole thing about the unorganized sector. You know, 93% of our employment is in the unorganized sector. And it's been like that for the last 60 years. So there's no way that we are going to transform this unorganized sector into the organized sector in the next 5, 10, 20, 50 years. It's never been done in any country. Even in China, it's still struggling, even after 30 years of unleashing their economic freedom. So that's the first thing, that who's going to solve that 93% of the piece, of employment? The second one is that remaining 7%, which is what we keep talking about and hearing about. And then the reality is that corporate India has not added a single job. I'm not saying a single percent, a single job in the last 5 years. And that's that 7%. So yes, we'll skill these people, but where are they going to find jobs? And you know where the jobs are being found? Now let me give you some startling statistics. We keep hearing about NREGA. Everybody's heard about NREGA. But does any of you in this room know that the total number of work days that the poultry industry has created last year is more than the total number of work days in under NREGA? Just the poultry industry. And who's supporting the poultry industry? Not the government. Under NREGA, the average number of work days is 11 or 12. And it keeps touting about the 100 number of work days. Why it has happened in the poultry sector is because it was a backyard poultry that existed till about 10 years back. And over these last 10 years, these people have got a little more, collectivized and organized. And today they're able to create so much more employment. And that's in the unorganized sector. Even in the poultry industry, it is not the organized sector which is creating the jobs. So I think we have to consider these realities. It's very easy to say that 280 million people will get out. These are armchair statistics, Dilip. The fact is that, yes, these 280 million people will come, but that doesn't mean that they're all going to get trained. Even if they get trained, where are we going to absorb them?
I fully agree that we already conceded through everything that they're not jobs in India.
Yeah.
But the challenge is that, they're going to be jobs in the world. Right? So we actually, in Africa is a challenge, like Ambassador Vora brought it out, but it's like saying that there are no jobs anywhere, so why should I send my student to school?
No, I didn't say that.
Your concept of the unorganized sector and the poultry thing, great example.
Yeah.
Okay? Because today in the Northeast, we want to set up poultry farms. We have to get entrepreneurs. So skill development is also about entrepreneurship development.
Correct.
We need to create a whole branch of entrepreneurs, including social entrepreneurs, Ambassador Vora, because that's a misunderstood term that is there. But we need to create entrepreneurs who would actually provide jobs to other people. And the entrepreneur, if I teach a person beauty and she joins a salon, it's okay. But if I teach a girl to do training in beauty, she goes back to a village and employs two other people by starting a beauty parlor in a village, that's great, right? So we have to find our solutions there and, just go on at it and put annual targets and monthly targets and try and achieve them.
Yeah, and coming to your point, just to support that, in terms of self-employment, we have, out of the 500 million workforce, there are 200 million people who are self-employed. Out of which 100 million are the farmers. There are 55 million small and micro enterprise non-farm enterprises in rural India, and then you have the MSME sector in urban India. So it's these 200 million people who are sustaining this country in terms of jobs and employment. It's not the organized sector, and that's why I keep pleading that let's not talk about jobs to be created through NASSCOM or to be. What does NASSCOM do to create 3 million? I mean, the total workforce in the IT sector is just 3 million. And we keep hearing examples about IT all the time, whereas we are talking about 500 million. Who's looking into the interest of the remaining 497 million?
Good point. Good digging. That's good.
I saw a hand. Yes.
Yes. There's
a question
one
here.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, right.
Yeah, this is Ambassador Vora's speciality. Right?
What is
that? Yeah, my question is to Mr. Dilip Chunai.
Yeah.
So you underlined that the value of vocational training and education can be enhanced with associate degree and its linkage with the secondary and tertiary education. You also referred about NSQF framework and sector skill council and so on. My question is, what are the challenges in terms of regulatory issues and other operational issues, and how NSDC is trying to address that?
You know, there is no, there is a debate whether we should get a vocational act, which is what Mr. Kashyap talked about. China has a vocational act, right? You know, India has this very good capability of finding loopholes and not respecting acts and all of that. And all I say is very, very simple. Supposing, you know, if all of us just take one conscious decision, we are going to support a certified person in skills, right? Each one of us can do it. If you want to hire a plumber coming home to you, say like, you know, I prefer to get a certified plumber, who at least know he'll do the job. And if I can do it on a phone app, you know, all the Uber has been banned, but you know, the same thing can apply for a plumber. And you know, if something happens to the plumber coming home, then the whole thing will happen, but we have to actually be conscious of that. If all of us say, if this institution says that my security guard who's standing outside the gate is certified by the Security Sector Council, or the people who are actually doing the video and audio work here are certified by the Media Sector Skill Council, which incidentally is chaired by Kamal Hassan, then the whole thing will change. Then you will find, and if industry advertised jobs, which they do in Malaysia, because I wanted to give the Asian example, Malaysia, all jobs are advertised according to the NSQF level and the standards set by industry, and industry is actually accepting it. I have seen in the last 3 days the first set of ads being issued by educational institution, training institutions, that we want people certified SSC level. So there's a lot of things we can do voluntarily, and we can support it. When you put an act to it, we have this uncanny ability to find loopholes, and we find certificates being sold and other things happening. You know, it's actually today mandatory for every electrician to be certified, otherwise he can't work in your home, but none of them are. So there are issues, and I think what we are trying to do is create this whole pull effect rather than a push effect there. And industry are now writing out their first letters that we will give, if you want to seek an interview in our company, please be SSC certified. So there's no cost to them, but you're creating, again, apologies to Ambassador Vora, but ecosystem that will enable this to happen.
Another question here, sir.
There's one question there.
There's one question right here in the
Sanjay.
Front.
So you're just giving me 90 seconds at the end, right?
Yes. The last question and then 90.
Afternoon. This question is to Ambassador Vora.
Thank God.
With the rise of BRIC nations, the demand for natural resources is tremendously growing across the world, and the natural destination for extraction of these resources obviously is Africa. Now, are the African government policies ready to tackle this demand? And how will the local interests versus the international demands are being handled?
Yes. I read you loud and clear, sir. That's a very good question. If I may be perfectly honest, the 2 million Chinese who have now come to, according to some, colonize Africa, are increasingly becoming the objects of resistance. All of them, 9 out of 10, the majority, are in the extractive industries. one out of 10 are challenging the local people, selling trinkets, toys, clothes, whatever, side by side with African vendors in the unorganized or informal sector. Yes, it is creating trouble. There has been violence in Zambia, there's been violence in Lesotho, in Nigeria, and a number of countries against this. Now the African governments, the ones that we deal with in the African Union, many of the leaders feel that they should renegotiate the contracts because Africa's known natural resources, Africa's known mineral resources, at the present rate of exploitation will run out, according to the Africans, in 50 years. Then what happens? So therefore skills, exactly what we're talking about, for sustainable employment becomes the alternative for them. Not to depend, exactly what happened in the construction industry in Egypt, this army of unemployed which toppled Mubarak, that is what we wish not to happen in so-called Black Africa. I'll conclude here. I talked a bit about African wisdom. May I take 15 seconds to ask you a question? Anyone here good in maths? Good, all of us are. When my wife's uncle died, he had 17 cows, and he willed that half be given to his wife, one-third to his daughter, and one-ninth to his son. Now, with 17 cows, we found it very difficult to give half to his wife, so the village gave one more cow, that made it 18. We gave half to the son, which is 9. We gave one-third to the daughter, which is 6, totals 15. We gave one-ninth to the son, which is 2, making a total of 17. And the 18th cow we took back since we had given it. That is African wisdom.
I'm really sorry. I don't think we're going to have time for another question, but Mr. Chinoy did want about 90 seconds to share something.
He's going to do it from the back. I just want to leave you with a visual, which is what we are trying to actually do in the country. So if some of you have seen it earlier, apologies.
तेरी मंजिल तेरे अंदर तेरे रास्ते तेरी किस्मत तेरे हाथों चुन ले अपना सफर सफर तेरा हुनर हुनर तेरी कदर कदर 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 रात की मेहनत रंग लाएगी अब सुबह पे हक जता ले अंधेरों से बढ़कर होती है उजाले की उमर उमर तेरा हुनर हुनर तेरी कदर कदर तेरा हुनर हुनर तेरी कदर कदर अपने हाथों की गर्मी से सूरज सुनहरा रोशन कर ले मौके चल के खुद आएंगे जाएगा तू जिधर जिधर जाएगा जिधर मौके चल के खुद आएंगे जाएगा तू जिधर जिधर तेरा हुनर हुनर तेरी कदर कदर तेरा हुनर हुनर तेरी कदर
सैकड़ों कोर्सेज में से मैंने चुना अपना मनपसंद कोर्स अब आप भी चुनिए सफलता की राह मिस कॉल दीजिए 0880055555 पर हुनर है तो कदर है
all our panelists for sharing their thoughts today. We've heard a lot of African wisdom today. And I can't help but sharing a pearl of Chinese wisdom that somebody just reminded me of yesterday. There was this young lecturer who came in for a guest lecture and she shared this famous Chinese proverb. And she said, give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. And teach a man to fish, and you feed him for a lifetime. So with that thought, we come to the conclusion of session 2 for today. Once again, thank you so much for coming in and sharing your thoughts. We're very grateful. I'm very honored to be on the same dais as speakers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.